U.S. Secretary of Labor Marty Walsh told us his wage and hour division is inundated with tens of thousands of complaints each year.
What do you say to people who've been waiting years to get wages that are owed to them, that have been stolen from them?
I would just say hang in there. I mean, our job is to do as quickly as we can to recoup the wages and the money that you're owed. And we're going to continue to fight for you every single day.
Lobbyists who oppose changing federal wage theft law argue it would hurt businesses and benefit trial lawyers more than employees.
We have to extract serious penalties if they are stealing money that is legally owed to a worker.
How hopeful are you that this legislation will get the support it needs to become law?
It's going to be difficult. It is going to be difficult.
For now, it remains largely up to the employee to monitor pay and fight for what's owed.
And that is a problem because under this current system, employers aren't getting any kind of message. And a new investigation by ProPublica in the state of New York has discovered that employees have been experiencing wage theft to a pretty severe extent. So their investigation uncovered that from 2017 to 2021, federal and state investigators found over 13,000 cases of wage theft in the state of New York alone. And those 13,000 cases affected approximately 127,000 workers. And according to ProPublica's report, those thousands of workers had over $203 million stolen from them during those 5 years alone. So how do these New York employers steal all that money? They do it in all sorts of like shady ways. For instance, if you work at a restaurant and some of the dishes broke during your shift, some of these employers will force the employees to pay for the broken dishes, stuff like that. And there are a lot of reasons why businesses can get away with wage theft, but today we're gonna focus on one in particular. So in New York, immigrants make up a massive portion of the state's workforce, especially when it comes to the restaurant industry. More than 60% of restaurant workers living in New York City are immigrants, according to a 2020 study by the New York State Comptroller's Office. Federal and state investigators determined that more than $52 million had been stolen from people working in restaurants, more than any other industry in New York, accounting for more than 25% of all reported wage theft. And in their piece on wage theft, ProPublica tells the story of one worker, Marcelino Zapoteco, who is an undocumented immigrant from Mexico who worked at a restaurant known as Brioso. Now, Brioso's co-owner, a man by the name of Pietro DiMaggio, deducted 5% of the workers' tips to pay for the computer system, whatever that means. I mean, you're the one running the business, you pay for those things, right? You pay for the computer system. Sometimes he would take even more. DiMaggio would also make his workers pay for broken plates and also for their own uniforms. But DiMaggio would also weaponize his employees' immigration status to essentially prevent them from reporting the abuse and mistreatment. When one of DiMaggio's employees complained about stolen tips, for instance, DiMaggio responded by threatening to report the employee to the immigration authorities, slamming tables and then firing him. And the state investigator who worked on Zapoteco's case wrote the following. Mr. DiMaggio would make statements to the Hispanic employees such as, quote, "I'll personally make sure that you all get sent back to Mexico," or "thank God that Trump is doing everything possible to get you guys the F out of here," end quote. So this doesn't surprise me at all, Mark, because I've seen so many instances of undocumented immigrants getting abused in the workplace, and they feel that they have no way to defend themselves because if they go to the authorities, they're worried that they'll get deported.
And from an employer's standpoint, that's the magic of the setup, and that's why we really don't get any immigration reform, because all of these things are linked, and there's a gray economy that is fueled by those who are here illegally. Slaughterhouses are overwhelmingly staffed by people who are here illegally. The entire Central Valley of California and agricultural concerns are overwhelmingly staffed by those who are in the country illegally. And it gives the employer so much leverage. And it also allows them to get whatever product they're working on done at a much reduced rate, mm-hmm. for all the reasons that we're talking about. You don't have to pay the same wages. So it's despicable, it's awful, because it's terribly difficult work, sometimes grotesque work in the case of, let's say, the slaughterhouse. Insanely difficult work in the case of those farm workers, and licking, working in the back of a kitchen all night, and you know, is no party either. And then at the end of that, to have wages stolen from you, it's just grotesque.
And think about what that also means for. So you have the undocumented immigrants who are getting abused; their wages are being stolen from them, and as they're being exploited. Think about what it means for other Americans. So if you think, who cares, right? They're breaking laws, they're here illegally, I have no empathy for them, who cares? Okay, but this kind of treatment, the only thing that trickles down is mistreatment in work, right? And so this has an impact of pulling everyone in the workforce down. And in fact, this is something that's been studied by the Economic Policy Institute. They say, and I agree with this, that wages for all workers in a certain industry go down when some of them are unable to defend themselves against this kind of mistreatment at the workplace. A recent comprehensive study conducted by a number of prominent scholars for the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine found that levels of immigration have only very small impacts on wages and employment. However, in certain local labor markets and industries where a significant share of workers are migrants who do not have access to worker protections and basic labor rights, migrant workers' lack of rights makes it difficult for them to bargain effectively for decent wages, and their weak leverage spills over to undercut the leverage of US workers, i.e. citizens and immigrants who are lawful permanent residents. I mean, it makes all the sense in the world. That doesn't surprise me at all.
And it's systemic, so that just points up the fact that it is a system. It's a system of exploitation. And as a result, you see no interest in changing it. I mean, it's very hard. And even in that back and forth in the tape piece from ProPublica, you could see that those even who are committed to change have to reluctantly say it's not gonna be easy.
Yeah, that video was actually from CBS News, which actually, to their credit, they also did a pretty good report just a month ago on wage theft that focused not just on New York, but wage theft in general in the country. But it's a huge problem. And I think this is also part of the reason why you see this effort to loosen child labor laws in the country. So rather than paying adults for this work, adults who, you know, might be more willing to demand better pay, better treatment, they want to employ literal minors to do some of these jobs. In fact, Mark, we did a story a few weeks ago about a poultry processing plant that had illegally employed a minor who had immigrated here from Guatemala. There was some sort of accident and he died as a result of being there and on the job. And so this kind of stuff happens all the time. We cover these stories all the time. And even in that clip that we showed you, where you have a Democratic lawmaker saying, no, 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 we need to do something about this. We need steeper fines. They don't care about your fines because their practices bring in way more money and way more profit than your fines could. So here's the question. If we deal with habitual, you know, shoplifters or individuals who are part of a shoplifting ring, like the case is made that they should spend time behind bars for what they're doing. In this case, we're talking about habitual thieves who literally steal money from the pockets of their own employees. Let's have a conversation about jail time. I think that would probably speak volumes.
That's such a great point, because the shoplifting, we're increasingly realizing, is a criminal enterprise. It's much bigger than just gangs going in. It's not a bunch of 15-year-olds. And similarly here, by Anna's point, I think it's a good one. It's a criminal enterprise going on. It's a way of doing business, a way of systematically stealing. And something on a bigger level has to be done besides fining them.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks. Really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member-only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.